When the Buddha explains the causes of suffering, he starts with ignorance. And from ignorance, he goes on to fabrication. In other words, it's because we fabricate out of ignorance that's why we suffer. And then everything else follows from that. Now the cure is to replace the ignorance with knowledge. Knowledge in terms of the Four Noble Truths. Exactly what is suffering or stress. What its cause is. The fact that it can be put an end by eliminating the cause, and then the path of practice that can eliminate the cause. You know these things and you apply them to your fabrication. That's the path. Ultimately, when your knowledge is complete, the mind no longer fabricates. At least at the moment of awakening, there's no fabrication at all. But to get there, you have to fabricate with knowledge. That's how you develop your knowledge, is you apply your knowledge to the way you fabricate the body through the breath, the way you fabricate speech through your mental chatter, which is basically direct to thought and evaluation, and then fabricate the mind through feelings and perceptions. You bring knowledge to these practices so you get a sense of where they're causing suffering and where they're not, where they're actually craving and clinging, and where they're a part of the path. You test your knowledge through fabricating. You see the results, and then you make your knowledge more and more refined. This is how your knowledge becomes a skill. It's interesting the word the Buddha uses here, awicca. It's the negative of awicca. And awicca can mean not only knowledge, but the kinds of skills that, say, a doctor would have or an animal trainer would have. And the Buddha often compares himself to a doctor and to a trainer. And basically, you want to become your own doctor and your own trainer. So you look at how you fabricate. And then you use that fabrication as part of the path. As the Buddha says, there are two ways that you can overcome the causes of suffering. In some cases, you just watch them. And in a John Lee's phrase, they get embarrassed and they go away. In other cases, you have to exert fabrication. In other words, you learn how to use these processes of bodily and verbal and mental fabrication with knowledge to counteract the greed, aversion, and delusion of the mind, the different kinds of craving and clinging. So these are your tools. And it's good to know the tools so that you can have them at hand. Something unskillful comes up in the mind. And sometimes watching it long enough, you finally get tired of it, but that can take years sometimes. But if you realize you have tools, you can speed up the process. We begin with the breath, which is, after all, bodily fabrication. Bring knowledge to how you breathe. Bring awareness to the fact that some ways of breathing actually aggravate your cravings and clingings and your suffering, and others alleviate it. That's applying the framework of the Four Noble Truths right there. Seeing the effect that the breath has in your mind, seeing the effect the breath has in your body, and then learning to adjust it. You have that within your power. And as you get more and more sensitive to the breath, you get more and more sensitive to very subtle levels of fabrication in the mind. This is why John Lee has you focus on the breath energy in the different parts of the body. The canon doesn't speak about that much. It simply notes the fact that there is a type of wind element or wind property that goes throughout all the organs of the body. And it talks about the diseases that come when that wind element gets upset. They're primarily the stabbing pains you sometimes feel in different parts of the body. They could be in the stomach, in the intestines, in the back, anywhere in the body. It's a sign that there's a lot of heavy breath energy and it's blocked. So there's a lot of pressure. And because it's right in the nerves, it's a very stabbing quality to that pain. So instead of just noting that that's one of the ways the mind and the body can suffer from the breath, you figure, well, what can I do to make the breath energy positive instead of negative? When you think of all the breath channels in the body opening up from including the nerves, the blood vessels, all the way out to the tips of the fingers, the tips of the toes, this really helps in the process of getting the mind to settle down. Because when there's a sense of ease or rapture that arises as the mind gets more and more quiet, one of the things you're going to have to do is allow it to spread throughout the body. And the easiest way to get it to spread throughout the body is by opening up the breath channels. And when you have this tool in your arsenal, you find that it's very useful for dealing with different unskillful thoughts that come up into the mind and have a very strong sense of urgency that you want this right now. Part of the body or mind feels starved for some kind of pleasure. Well, you can breathe in a way that gives that pleasure. Open up all the breath channels in the body. And you may notice that some parts of the body, as you relax them and the breath goes through them, are especially helpful, sometimes in the hands or the feet, because these are places where tension tends to build up very quickly. When there's greed or lust or anger. So this is one of the ways in which you can counteract the force of those defilements by fabricating bodily fabrication. And there's verbal fabrication, the way you talk to yourself about that particular defilement. When a very strong defilement comes into the mind, it's like there's a bully in the classroom. And no matter how reasonable you are with it, the bully just pushes everything away, refuses to talk, refuses to listen to your reasoning. And then you start siding with a bully. That's where you go wrong. You have to realize the bully doesn't have nearly as much power as he thinks he does. And if the bully is stubborn, you can be stubborn too. Just keep thinking about other things, the opposite of whatever would aggravate that particular defilement. If it's lust, you start thinking about the unattractive side of the body. And you think about all the unskillful things you do under the power of lust. And you remind yourself there's nothing really gained by that kind of thinking. In other words, you talk to yourself in a different way. You don't totally allow the conversation to be taken over by the bully. And you find that some of the bully's reasonings prove pretty hollow. Like the bully would say, you're going to have to give in to me at any time. You're going to have to give in to me at some time anyhow, so you might as well give in quickly. You don't have to agree with that. You can say, not responsible for 5 minutes from now, but I am responsible for right now. And for right now, I'm going to say no. In other words, think in ways that are even more stubborn than the bully. And as you do that, you'll find that a lot of the bully's reasons that used to be so convincing or so overwhelming prove pretty hollow. And that conviction you had that you had to give in to the desire, had to give in to the anger, there's no had to there at all. There's just one part of the mind bullying another part of the mind. So you reframe the issue. Think in different terms. And at the very least, you can withstand the power of that thought. And you begin to see there are other sides to the equation. For instance, when lust comes up and the bully says, okay, the body needs this, The body doesn't need anything. The body's perfectly willing to die. It'll die if you let it. It'll have hunger, pains, and all these others, but the body itself doesn't really care. It's the mind that cares. And it's the mind that wants these things. The body is just the tool of the mind. So the problem is not the body, it's the lust in the mind. And why would it lust for these things? What does it gain? Is lust in and of itself a comfortable emotion? Well, it's not. It just forces your nerves and puts pressure on your nerves, and then you look for some sort of release. But again, if you can use the breath to help your verbal fabrication here, you can release a lot of that pressure. And the whole thing seems pointless. All the demands that the bully made. So this is one of the ways in which you use verbal fabrication together with bodily fabrication to help see through the false reasoning of the defilements. And finally, there's mental fabrication, your feelings and perceptions. Again, the breath is helpful here. You can create feelings of ease and well-being throughout the body. It has a really healthy effect on the mind. You look at greed, aversion, and delusion, and you begin to realize they're not worth the effort because there's a sense of well-being already. The reason you give in to these things is because they promise a greater sense of ease or well-being, a greater pleasure than what you have. But if you can create feelings of pleasure as you need them, with the way you direct your thoughts to the breath and the way you evaluate the breath, then those other demands will weaken. And then your perceptions, how you perceive things. This is really important. The pictures we present ourselves with as we think about the world, think about the body, think about the mind, think about greed, aversion, and delusion of the mind. What are the underlying images? Do you have an image of yourself as being constantly starved for well-being? That you're harried and harassed by your daily life and you need some sort of fix? Can you change the perception? Here you are. You're a master of your breathing. You're in control. When you get angry about somebody else's misbehavior, what's your perception of yourself at that moment? The judge who has the right to pass judgment on other people. Is that the situation you're in? As the Buddha said, it's better to regard yourself as a person walking through a desert. You're tired, hot, trembling, exhausted. You need water. You find a little bit of water anywhere, you should be willing to drink it. In other words, focus on the good points of other people. Even though you admit they have their bad points, you don't let them spoil your mind. Because if you see other people being just totally bad, it's hard to treat them with justice, hard to treat them with fairness. You simply see yourself as the victim, or see yourself as the judge. There's that perception in the back of the mind that colors everything you're going to do and say in that situation. Change the perception. When somebody insults you, if you perceive yourself as your honor has been besmirched, you've got to fight back. The Buddha gives you another perception. Someone has offered you bad food. And if you don't take it, then it's theirs. You're not poisoned by it. This is one of the reasons we read the text, is to get other perceptions to apply to different situations. That's that image of the person pinned down by bandits. They're going to saw off his arms and legs. The Buddha says, even in a situation like that, if you allow yourself to feel ill will for those people, you're not doing the teaching. Learn how to spread goodwill even to those people. Practice that in your mind. And when you've been able to practice that in your mind, then when you meet up with the little problems here and there in the world, It's a lot easier to feel goodwill for people. And remember what goodwill is. That's a good perception to remember to hold in mind, too. It's not that you just want to say, may you be happy whatever you're doing. It means may you understand the causes of true happiness and may you act on them. That kind of goodwill you can wish for anybody. So avail yourself of these tools. Learn to use your bodily fabrication, your verbal fabrication, your mental fabrication with knowledge. After all, the mind's fabricating things anyhow. In fact, it's this process of fabrication that we bring to our experience of the world. We prime ourselves to see certain things or see things in certain ways, to hear things in certain ways and smell, taste them, experience their physical contact in certain ways, think about them in certain ways, because of the way the mind has already started fabricating things, even prior to the sensory contact. Because that often happens with ignorance, that's why we suffer, even when things are good. But if you understand this point, that if you bring knowledge to this process of fabrication, then you're bringing good fabrications, skillful fabrications to your awareness of the things around you. And that right there alleviates a lot of the suffering. So you're using your wisdom, you're using your understanding, not to just take note of things, but to realize you're already shaping them, so you might as well shape them in a good way. Shape them so they can be a path, rather than just one more instance of one more cycle through suffering and craving. You've got the choice. So always keep that in mind and make the best use of it.